are here who attend this church regularly. I'm sure you know Christopher Nicewalder very well. And unlike most of the speakers of this conference, I never knew Greg Bahnsen. In fact, in 1995, when Greg Bahnsen went to meet our Creator, I was just getting started in the Reformed faith. I'll tell you a short story. Not knowing Greg Bahnsen won't prevent an anecdote. When I was about 19, it was 1993, I was about 1994, I was in the, I'd been raised nominally in the Lutheran churches, but never really actively embraced the faith. And when I went to high school, my mother had divorced a second time, and I kind of dove off into heathenism. And I was playing in secular rock and roll bands, terrible, with a friend of mine who was an Assembly of God backslider. And at one point he decided he needed to get back into church. And so he went back, invited me. Long story short, my Lutheran background had not prepared me for an Assembly of God service. But I had a background in family music, and I absolutely loved the worship service. So long story short, I actively embraced Christ at that place, despite the Arminian theology and everything else. I came to faith in Christ Jesus. Strongly began to study, read, and devour everything I could, and switched my musical tastes from that darned old secular rock and roll stuff to good, healthy, wholesome Christian rock. And a fellow that Christopher Nicewalder knows very well, I also found at the time a young man named Christopher Scott. And Mr. Scott had a great Christian rock band that I began to listen to along with my friends. And one day I went to my friend's house, and his dad was a plumber, had done some work for a local Christian bookseller. And this Christian bookseller was a Calvinist and had given my friend's dad a copy of Dwayne Spencer's little booklet entitled Tulip. And I picked it off up on the table and I said, "What is this?" My bibliolustful mind wants to know. And my friend's dad jerked it out of my hands and said, "You don't want to read that stuff. That's that Calvinism stuff this guy believes." That same night, my friend had just got the latest issue of the Christian rock magazine called Heaven's Metal. That same night, in the same house, I picked it up, and there was an interview with that young man named Christopher Scott, and I opened it up, and it was asking him about his belief in Calvinism. And he began to lay out what he believed the Calvinist life and worldview was and the doctrines of grace. And I read it and I thought, well, this can't be that controversial. I believe this. And long story short, this led me on a path to become Reformed. I found the closest Reformed church to me in Arkansas at the time was an hour away. I went there, again leaving out all the great details, ran into a guy named Gary North at that church. He had moved there for this small event called Y2K. I met his family, married his daughter, and I was looking at my CD. This shows how ancient I am. CDs were those things that came before digital audio. From Christopher Scott's band called Precious Death. And I opened it up and there was all these talk inside about Reformed theology and great theologians like St. Augustine and John Calvin and Luther and Spurgeon and all these guys. And he had a list of his favorite books in there. At the top, if I remember correctly, was R.C. Sproul's The Holiness of God. And we went down the list, and among all these great Reformed luminaries was a book from Gary North, Tools of Dominion. And I thought, I gotta show this to Gary North. So I showed it to him. He got a good laugh out of it. I don't think I ever played the music for him. But the irony of the story is, as some of you know, but most of you don't, is that that young man named Christopher Scott is none other than the young man who's helping put on this conference, standing by the back wall there, Christopher Nicewalder. And so I want to say to him as I come up here, thank you not only for inviting me to speak at this conference, it's such a wonderful topic, but thank you for helping me when I was young in the Reformed faith. Find the right path. And the right path is through John Calvin and Gary North and R.J. Rushdoony and the topic of discussion this evening, which is Greg Bahnsen. And what they've taught about the fullness of the Reformed faith from the scriptures, which covers many topics, and others will be covering other topics tonight that I'd like to talk on all of them, but I don't get to. I have been asked to talk about specifically apologetics and specifically apologetical methodology. And that is at the point at which most congregations would just fall out of sleep immediately. Every young seminary student in his first or second sermon has to use the word epistemology to show how smart he is. But it is a very important topic. So as I thought about the many ways to cover this and so much to say on the topic, I, of course, not knowing Bahnsen myself, not being able to share all the anecdotes of what he did, all I can share is his legacy and what he taught me through him and through his mentor, Cornelius Van Til, in presuppositional apologetic methodology. So I chose as my topic this evening the intellectual challenge of the gospel. Let me briefly say what I mean by intellectual challenge of the gospel. I'm not talking about the challenge of the gospel that happens to be intellectual in character. There is that. The gospel is intellectual. It is emotional. It is spiritual. It's a whole range of things. It speaks to the whole man. It challenges the whole man. And you could give a lecture on that part of the challenge of the gospel that happens to be intellectual. But I want to talk about the challenge of the gospel and how it challenges the intellect of the whole man. Specifically going, as Van Til did, as Bahnsen always did, directly from the scriptures, directly from Romans 1. I'll read that in just a second. But this comes as a controversial topic because we know there are so many attempts at the Christian apologetics out there. I go into the bookstores and I see huge shelves of books on Christian apologetics. Some of them are evidentialist school, some of them are classical school, some of them, since Alvin Plantinga, are called Reformed epistemology. And I don't think it's Reformed personally, but that's a debate for another day. And among these, there's this odd bird called presuppositional transcendental apologetic, and it doesn't sound very inviting, but all it really is taking Romans 1 seriously. Romans 1, beginning in verse 18. Whatever translation you're following with in your Bible is going to be wrong, because not one of them gets it exactly right. They all have the pieces of it. I want to read it as I see it, as best I can. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven upon all unrighteousness and ungodliness of men who are holding the truth down in unrighteousness. You could say who are suppressing the truth in unrighteousness. For that which could be known of God is clear to them. For God showed it to them. For the unseen things of God from the creation of the world, in the things that are made, are clearly understood, being perceived. Even his eternal power and divine nature, so that they are without excuse. For, having known God, they did not glorify him as God or give thanks, but became vain in their reasonings and darkened in their foolish hearts. We'll read a little more in a minute. There are a couple of points I want to make about this to begin with on the methodology of apologetics from the scriptures. The first is about creation and the knowledge of God. And from these scriptures, it is very clear that every man, even in his fallen state, knows God. Verse 21 says, "For having known God, they did not glorify him as God or give thanks." So that is the first point of all apologetical methodology. And this is extremely important. And if anything I say tonight doesn't sink in or come across or sounds confusing, get this. They know him. Every unbeliever of every religion or non-religion, atheism, agnosticism, Buddhism, Taoism, Islam, Rastafarianism, or I don't know what in the heck I believe ism, they know God. They know him. If you're the kind of person who likes to take a pen or a highlighter and write in your Bible, underline that phrase. They know him. And let me repeat one more time. They know him. What does verse 19 say? "For the things that can be known of God are clear to them." It's not just that they know him. What can be known of him is clear to them. The Greek word for clear here is phaneros. It's the word from which old churchmen get the word epiphany. Epiphany in the old liturgical calendar is the season in which they celebrate after Christmas the revealing of the light of the world to the Gentiles, when the wise men come from afar and see Jesus and the glory of God is revealed unto the Gentiles. This bright light that shines to the world, this revealing of the Son of God to the world, that word is the word being used here. It is clear, it is open, it is manifest, it is a light shining. And that word is not only important for its emphasis, but for what comes next. It is clear to them. God has shown it to them. And the Greek word for "has shown" is from the exact same root as phaneros. They're saying it's clear to them because God has made it clear to them. God has ensured that there is no obstacle between him and them in the understanding of the things that can be known of him. And not only is it clear, but it says that it's understood. In verse 20, for the unseen things of him from the creation of the world, in the things that are made, being perceived have been clearly seen. That's what it literally says. Being perceived. The Greek word literally means they understand it up here. And the word "following" literally means they have a bird's eye view of it. They're standing right over it, looking at it, and they perceive it. They know him. What do they know? Verse 18 makes it clear. It is the truth that they are suppressing in unrighteousness. So they know the truth. Verse 19 makes it clear that they know that which can be known about God. Verse 20, the unseen things of him, they know. That's always the atheist's first line of defense, by the way.
I can't see God.
Can you see God? Why do you believe in God? You can't see him. There's no evidence for God. You know what the word evidence means? It means I can't see it. A video. From seeing. What does this say? It says, it doesn't matter if you can see him or not. The unseen things of God are still clearly understood from the things that are made. Even his eternal power and his divine nature. So what can be known of God? They know. So what is their argument when they stand before God to say, I don't believe in God, I don't believe in Christ, I don't believe in the Bible? What is their argument? Paul tells us, they're without excuse. And for those of you who follow Bunsen, you know what that word means. The Greek word is anapologetus. It literally means they are without an apologetic. So in the intellectual challenge between the Christian and the non-believer, whatever the non-believer is arguing against the existence of God, it amounts to, you ain't got nothing. And we have to remember that. No discussion of apologetical method would be complete without a quotation from Van Til. Here's what he says in his book, which is titled the same as this discussion is. Quote, there is no fault in the objective revelation of God to men. It is perspicuous. No one can escape being confronted with it. There is no area of impersonal relationships where the face of God, the Creator and Judge, does not confront man. It is not as though the evidence shows that a God exists, or that God probably exists. If such were the case, then there would be some excuse for man if he did not bow to his Maker. Nor is it as though the evidence for theism were clear, but the evidence for Christianity were obscure. Paul boldly asserts that men are bound to believe the facts of Christianity as soon as they hear of them. When he declares that the fact of the resurrection of Christ declares the fact of the resurrection of Christ, he asserts in Acts 17:31 that through it all men have been given assurance of the day of final judgment by the Son of Man. Through Paul's gospel, then, objective truth stands before men as a challenge. Men cannot react to it neutrally, cannot react neutrally towards it. They must accept it or suppress it because they do not want to believe it. That is the argument Paul is making in Romans 1. They know him. It is clear to them. What can be known of him is clear to them. He's made it clear to them. There is no escape from the clarity of it. They don't have an argument against it. It is nothing but the suppression of that. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven upon all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who are holding the truth in unrighteousness. The word holding or suppressing there is the Greek word kakonton. It literally means to hold down. And I always liken it to someone in a swimming pool who has a basketball or a volleyball, is trying to hold it under the water. And it's impossible, unless you're a very, very strong man, to hold that down. Even then, it wants to roll its way out. It's fighting to come to the surface. And it takes the active work of suppression to keep it held down. And that is the lot of the fallen man before the face of God. He is suppressing that truth in unrighteousness. They suppress the truth. And this takes us beyond the knowledge of God to man, to the effects of the fall upon the knowledge of man. They are suppressing the truth, as the text says. And that makes us realize that when it comes to apologetical methodology, you are not dealing with an intellectual argument alone. Obviously, it involves intellect. You have to make speech and argument and stuff like that. But that is not the core of it. It is not an intellectual error on the part of the atheist. It is an ethical transgression that you're dealing with. You are not talking face to face, as it were, with a student. You're talking to a divine, cosmic rebel. His need is not more information. How could anyone read this text? How could any evidentialist apologist or classical apologist read this text that says they know him, they know what can be known of him, it is clear to them, it is perceived, they've got a bird's eye view. Maybe if I just elucidate the ontological argument in a more sound form, he might go for it this time. Maybe if I just show him a model of the Big Bang Theory that shows that it had to have originated from a divine source, they don't need more information. They've got all they need now. They need the grace of Christ. And they need to be challenged intellectually in a different way. The problem is with all of these methodologies that don't begin with the true understanding of Romans 1 here. That's what they want to do. They want to build arguments upon arguments. They want to build evidences upon evidences. And if I can just put enough evidence together and enough arguments together and string them together, eventually this person will see the light and be led through those steps of human reason until they acquiesce to the truth of God. And that is just the opposite of what this text is teaching. That is not the methodology of Scripture. Let me show you who it is the methodology of. Genesis 3. Now the serpent was more crafty than any other beast of the field that the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God actually say, 'You shall not eat of any tree in the garden?'" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat of the fruit of the trees in the garden, but God said, 'You shall not eat of the fruit of the tree that's in the midst of the garden, neither shall you touch it, lest you die.'" But the serpent said to the woman, "You will not surely die. For God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, that it was a delight to the eyes, and the tree was to be desired to make one wise. By the way, that's James talking about the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. She also gave some to her husband. She took of the fruit and ate, and she also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate. Notice the serpent's methodology. He came to Eve, and he questioned the word of God. Did God actually say that? And he got her to repeat it. And in repeating it, she added to it. That's another debate. And then the serpent says, "You will not surely die." So now he goes from merely questioning the word of God, which gets her questioning the word of God, to now outright contradicting the word of God. And then watch what he does. "For God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be open and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." Question God, contradict God, supplant God. This is the methodology of autonomy, of being a law unto oneself, not submitting to the law of God, not submitting to the revelation that God has shown to you and made clear to you, but taking it upon yourself to be counseled by the devil or to be counseled by your own heart and to posit your own arguments, to posit your own reasons, to posit your own authorities. And that was how the devil led mankind into the fall. And Eve was deceived and she fell for it, and Adam rebelled and did the same thing. But consider the process that went on in Eve's mind during this point. "Hath God said this?" "Yes, God has said this." "No, you won't die." At that moment, it was over. Now that's a huge theological debate. I'm not trying to spark that debate. Did she fall when she thought about it, or did she fall when she actually ate the fruit? I'm not trying to go there. Speaking colloquially, at that moment it was over. Because what had she done? She had stepped off of the sheer word of God and submission to it, and she'd begun to reason in her own mind. Maybe this is not so bad after all. And the moment you begin to do that, the moment you begin to diminish the clear word of God for yourself, the moment you are becoming like the serpent, not like God, you are questioning the word of God, you're beginning to contradict the word of God, holding it in question, and you're beginning to supplant the word of God. And that's the great irony of the fall. This couple didn't have to become like God. They already were like God. They were created in the image and likeness of God. There was nothing in the universe that was more like God than they were. And yet the serpent tempts them, and they lose it. And instead of becoming more like God, they become more like the serpent. And that's what we're tempted today to do, even when we confront unbelievers. We're tempted to think like this. Let's posit reasons and arguments and compile evidences. And in many cases, the apologists who are doing this will say up front, I'm not going to use Scripture. You think I'm joking? That's what they say. They think they're going to make a connection with that unbeliever out there by leaving all the supernatural divine stuff out of it. Look, guys, I don't even need my supernatural stuff. And they say this up front. And then they begin to build arguments and evidences and reasons. And it is to depart from what God taught right here. Because that person knows Him. They don't need more information. They need grace. And grace comes by, obviously, by the providence of God, the sovereignty of God. But the apologetical encounter has to be one that attacks those faulty premises to begin with and shows them you can't believe in God this way because you're standing on your own sin. But let me show you what that does. Let me show you the folly that that leads you to. And this is something that even the opponents of presuppositional apologetics have always cheered it for, in its ability to attack the foundations of the unbelieving thought and drive it to utter irrationality by pointing out its logical implications. Now, I've got about 400 pages of notes here. We probably won't be able to get to all of them this evening. But hey, we're Presbyterians, right? What effect did that fall have upon human thought? The text that we just read says it. These people who are suppressing the truth of God in unrighteousness, what happened to their reasoning ability, their reasoning in general, as a result of that? The text goes on to tell us. Even though they knew God, they did not honor Him as God or give thanks, but they became futile in their speculations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Professing to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the incorruptible God for an image in the form of corruptible man and birds and four-footed animals and crawling creatures. The Hebrew, or the Greek word is herpeton. It means reptiles. I prefer to translate it snakes. And therefore God gave them over in the lusts of their hearts to impurity, so that their bodies would be dishonored among them, for they exchanged the truth of God for a lie, and worshipped and served the creature rather than the Creator, who's blessed forever. Amen. Several points to notice here. First, what were the consequences of this action of suppressing the truth in unrighteousness? Was it a lack of knowledge about arguments? No, it says they became futile in their speculations and their foolish heart was darkened. Couple points. Futile. If you have a King James, I believe it says vain. This is where it's important to go to seminary. People are always ragging on seminarians because they bust out their Greek knowledge and all that. Well, sometimes it's helpful. As most of you probably know, because you're so well trained by your pastor, there was a Greek translation of the Old Testament called the Septuagint. It's called that because that's the Greek word for 70, and allegedly, by legend, there were 70 Hebrew scholars who translated this under divine inspiration. That's hooey, but that's what they call it. The 70, the Septuagint. And that's important because as the New Testament writers were communicating in Greek, more often than not, when they quoted from the Old Testament, they quoted the Greek version rather than the actual Hebrew. And so we have lots of quotations of that Greek Old Testament in the New Testament. We have lots of references to it. And one of them, I believe, is right here. It's a technical term used all through the Old Testament to refer to idolatry as nothingness. An idol is a nothing. And that's exactly the word Paul uses right here. They became nothingness, vain in their speculations. It's the exact same Hebrew word used in Ecclesiastes 1. Vanity of vanities, saith the preacher. All is vanity. And of course, you know the whole chorus of the argument of that book. I've tried it all in the world. I had riches, I had poverty, I had women, I had fame, I had power. I built a wall, it fell on me, I dig a pit, I fall in it. You can't win by man's devices. It's all vain. It's vanity. It's nothingness. Let us hear the conclusion of this. Fear God and obey His commandments. That's the book of Ecclesiastes for you in a nutshell. That's exactly the argument Paul is making here. The men who suppressed the truth in unrighteousness, they became futile, vain. They became Ecclesiastes 1. In their speculations. Speculations. Greek word dialogismos. I don't know how in the world the translators get speculations out of that word from which we get our word dialogue. It's not really talking about speculations and things up there in the air and King James's imaginations. The ESV gets it closest, I believe, by translating it as reasonings. They became futile in their reasonings. And now we're beginning to see what the Bible's trying to tell us about apologetics. If you stick with God, you know God. You're in submission to Him. But the foolish man who's fallen in nature suppresses that truth and unrighteousness, and as a result, he runs into complete irrationality when it comes to his reasonings. And their foolish heart was darkened. And yet it says they engaged in philosophy. They professed themselves wise. They professed themselves sophos, philosophers. I am Aristotle. I am Plato. I am Anaximenes. I am Anaximander. I am Parmenides. They were philosophers, very distinguished men, vain, professing themselves to be philosophers. They became, the Greek word, if I remember correctly, is morons. The root word is the word we get our word morons from. They became fools. It's kind of funny, our translations drive so much of how we feel about our religion. If you call someone a fool, it's almost, we bristle. That's on edge. Be careful with that word because of what Jesus said. But if you call him a moron, we all laugh and we get over it. We understand that. Strange thing, the English language. They professed themselves to be philosophers, and yet they were fools. They rejected man as the image of God. This goes right back to what I was saying from Genesis 3. The methodology of the serpent. They exchanged the glory of the incorruptible God for an image in the form of corruptible man and of birds and of four-footed animals and of snakes. The glory of the incorruptible God for an image in the form or an image, a likeness of the image. All the translations, again, have different versions of this. The two Greek words there are the same two Greek words from Genesis 1:26. God created man in his image and his likeness. Paul transports those words over here, very rarely used, by the way, transports them right in the middle of this discussion and says that they exchanged the glory of God for the image of a corruptible man and of beasts and birds and all the rest. What's he saying? These people have despised in themselves the image of God in which they're created. The suppressing of the truth and unrighteousness about God immediately begins the suppressing of the truth and unrighteousness about man. No wonder your reasonings become vain when you do something like that. And instead of identifying with the glory of the God in whose image you are created, you begin to identify with the animals. What do we see in our world today? Darwin. What is evolution? Except that very passage right there. Well, of course your reasonings are going to be vain, because you've exchanged it for nothing but brute lust and survival instinct and herd mentality. No wonder we've got socialism. We've got people who have transferred themselves into herds of cattle intellectually. And they prefer that rather than turn to the only path of freedom, which is God Himself. Now I'm getting into politics, and that's someone else's topic for tomorrow. They exchanged the truth of God for a lie. Exchanged here. Some translations say transformed. The commentators make a good point here that really means exchanged. It means traded. The Greek word means they traded it. And what I don't know that Paul was thinking this, but to my mind it brings up Esau. Exchanging his birthright for a bowl of pottage. It brings up Judas. Exchanging his soul for 30 pieces of silver. This is what's going on in this verse. You're trading the glory of God in whose image you're created because you're holding down that truth and unrighteousness. And the last aspect of that is that God says, okay, if that's what you want, that's what you get. And He gives them over to their own spiritual corruptions. Human autonomy, wishing to justify itself apart from God, grasps and strains at every possible straw of human experience, trying at various times and from multiple angles to create a lasting foundation for existence and knowledge and ethics and meaning and value and progress. But in the end, it is vanity, and it is the apologist's job not to try to go reason with them on their terms, but to point out the vanity of their terms and to show them the proper way, which is Jesus Christ. I have no idea where I'm at on time. I think that says I have 45 minutes left. I was told an hour and a half, so. I have never wanted to preach anyone into a corner where they can't go to the bathroom. So if you go to the bathroom, you're going to offend me. Babies cry, it doesn't offend me. If God wants to drown me out, I'm sure He can find enough babies to cry that I'll get the point. The most unpopular embodiment of the humanistic idea appears among skeptics and so-called scientific-minded unbelievers, among whom nature can be best defined by what it is not. Nature is the basis of naturalism. Everything must be nature. We must study nature. And yet they always define nature by what it is not, namely, a universe beholden to a personal creator God who sustains nature, who interferes when He wants to with the laws of nature, answering prayers, performing miracles, raising dead bodies, and things like that. Consequently, this group of naturalists, as they like to call themselves, believes in a universe that never operates at variance with natural laws. Laws which themselves exist inherently in and because of nature itself. This belief gives rise to a secondary belief called uniformitarianism. I know big words too. The idea that the universe and everything in it, from all of history, remains uniform in its operation, and it always will. Now, such a worldview creates many problems. If we take the methodology they were supposed to, and take the premises of their reasoning and drive them to their logical conclusion, and show the fallacy of it. Folly, fallacy, etc. Firstly, it is arbitrary. And the first thing to understand about any arbitrary belief is that it is a dogma. Scientists don't like you to remind them that they're dogmatists, because it's the first thing they always want to lash out at in college classes. Science must be done according to the scientific method, not according to any dogma. Really? Can miracles exist? No. Why not? Because nature's uniform, it always has been, always will be. Really? Have you tested all of nature? No. Can you know the future? No. Then you believe nature is going to be like that and always has been. Well, yeah, but it's a scientific belief. These kinds of discussions go on all the time. Usually they don't go on because smart Christian students just sit there and let the professors go on, take their test, get their grade, and go home. Some fights are just not worth fighting. But the first thing to know is that that is a dogma. The scientist who believes naturalism is doing it on pure faith. He cannot prove it. He cannot prove it was always like that, and he cannot prove it always will be like that. So he's just as much as a dogmatist as you are. I'm always tempted when I argue with guys like this to ask them for their creedal confessions. The origin of species. They never quite get the joke. While the universe does display amazing orderliness, all philosophers will agree that the limitations of human knowledge make it impossible to prove a negative claim such as no supernatural God exists. So while we can trust the orderliness of the universe to a large degree, we can engage in science, we can generate remarkably precise predictions based on science, we cannot logically jump to the abstract conclusion that such orderliness is the primary, let alone the only attribute of nature or of reality. To do so would be to operate on an unproven assumption and thus would reveal more about the naturalist's biases than about reality. What we see here is that suppression of the knowledge of God at work. To maintain his arbitrarily chosen belief about nature, the naturalist explains away alternative views from within the confines of and using the limited tools of his own worldview. Since he's excluded any miraculous event or supernatural event or intervention by definition in his worldview, then no evidence of a miracle could ever change his mind. Why not? Because if he's ever confronted with a miracle, even an extreme miracle, for example, a resurrection from the dead, the naturalist would still attempt to take recourse to some naturalistic explanation. And this is exactly what you see anytime you argue with these guys. On the one hand, he may attempt to offer a natural explanation for what happened. For example, perhaps corpses can really come back from the dead for reasons we don't know about. Perhaps if given the right medical circumstances, CPR or defibrillator placed just properly, these things could happen. Or my favorite naturalistic explanation is the Princess Bride explanation. He was only mostly dead. On the other hand, he may consent, that naturalistic science currently has no explanation for what happened, but, quote, scientists are working on it, and will ultimately arrive at one of those explanations. It was one of the great gems in the famous Bonson-Stein debate, which is so less talked about because of the famous exchange over the laws of logic, which is what everyone remembers. But near the end of the debate, in the Q&A, someone asked Dr. Stein if he observed a miracle, an actual miracle before his eyes, would he change his mind? And he basically gave the answer that I just gave for this dead corpse. And he said, even if I could not prove what happened, I would still hold out judgment so that it could be studied scientifically. And Dr. Bonson answered very cleverly by saying, "Thank you for acknowledging that scientists live by faith." Because that answer just shows the dogmatism of the person that he's going to hold out no matter what for his naturalistic explanation. He believes, ultimately, there will be one. It shows that even the naturalist's own criteria of judgment, that is, of natural evidence, could never change his fundamental commitments, even when the evidence contradicts those commitments. Since he's already predetermined in his own mind that nothing exists except uniform nature, he will reinterpret any contradictory evidence as somehow not contradictory. And this means that nature and evidence truly do not form the basis of the naturalist worldview, despite how much he talks about the fact. Rather, his own unproven assumptions about nature, excluding God, form the unchallengeable basis of his worldview. In other words, if you argue with a naturalist enough, he will admit, ultimately, in his own way, that all he's doing is suppressing the truth of God and unrighteousness. He won't put it in those terms, but that's what he will be saying. Now, of course, Jesus speaks about this problem in Luke 16. It's a great parable about a man who dies, goes into torment, suddenly turns into an evangelist, and wants to go back and save his brothers. People always become evangelists in hell, I suspect. And so he calls out to Abraham and says, "Please, send the poor man Lazarus," which shows that fallen people don't change their nature once they're in hell. He still wants somebody to do it for him. He still wants servants. Still thinks he should be served. Anyway, "Go back and save my brothers." "Oh, no. They got the word of God and the law and the prophets," as Abraham's response. The old man says, "No, but if somebody came back from the dead, they would believe." And Abraham preaches. Bonson's apologetic at that moment. They have the law and the prophets. If they don't believe them, neither would they believe if one rose from the dead. That is Bonson's and Van Til's apologetic. Those who are unmoved by the supernatural power of God's word will also remain unmoved by a supernatural intervention in nature. Even one as drastic as a resurrection, evidence will not move them, because their fundamental commitment is not for nature or for evidence, but against the personal God. That is the fundamental orientation at which we have to fight against. I've got great examples of this in my book, Biblical Logic, which is not here. I'm not trying to sell books. But from which my notes are taken. Yes, I'm trying to sell books. Who am I kidding? Great examples from the new atheist Daniel Dennett, Richard Dawkins. By the standards of many professional philosophers, many of whom are atheists themselves, these guys are lightweights. Nevertheless, they make good foils. Daniel Dennett, Richard Dawkins, a couple of others, including the Humanist Manifesto too, showing how this principle works. Over and over again, they want anything but the supernatural. Anything but God. Richard Dawkins was once famously, now, thanks to Ben Stein, pushed into a corner to say that yes, even if man was created, it had to have been by another being that had come along by evolution. Not realizing the infinite regress that comes out of that. And even so much that he was openly asked, could it have been an alien? And he essentially said yes. Which is true. An unbeliever would rather believe in an alien and panspermia theory or something like that than submit to the Creator God. So I've got all these examples. I don't have time to go through them because I've got so much great stuff I want to get to, and I've got a good 15 left, maybe a little more. But I want to show you what happens. It doesn't stay just there at the level of metaphysics. It doesn't stay there at this debate between naturalism and God. As the exegesis made clear, he begins to identify, instead of with God, with the image of animals and corruptible man. And it goes from his theory of being into his theory of knowledge, into his theory of ethics, into his theory of judgment, into his theory of progress. It goes through all 5 points of the covenant: God, man, law, sanctions, and inheritance or time. And it affects all of them. What happens to knowledge? Well, once the secularist has presupposed the worldview of naturalism, he's automatically adopted a subjectivist position. He has unwittingly destroyed the possibility of objective knowledge. He's unwittingly destroyed the possibility of communication that is objective. Because of his autonomous stance. And that sounds like an exaggeration. But if no overarching authority exists to definitively communicate truth to us as separate individuals, then each individual stands autonomously as they declare their human autonomy from God. They all stand as individuals autonomously from each other as well. Their self-reverential standing has at its basis nothing less than the individual, and it can use as its tools of proof nothing more than that which the individual self can produce. So when the naturalist speaks of reason and evidence, we have to understand how his worldview does to reason and evidence within the limits of his own worldview. While he practically operates as if this, his reasons and his evidence and his experiences stand objectively out there for everyone else to experience and talk about as well, what we see is that he can't prove this. He assumes that there's an objective natural world out there. But since his assumption originates from the authority of his own mind, then his touted objectivity actually rests upon his personal opinions. And thus he is a subjectivist. By reason and evidence, we can only understand him to mean his own personal reason and evidence. And his own personal experiences cannot stand as authoritative for anyone but him, and in fact, they can't stand as authoritative for him either. Only if some overarching authority actually upholds the objectivity of the universe could we have any certainty that reason and evidence apply to people in general. In short, those who stand with autonomy fall with autonomy. And this remains true no matter what theory of knowledge you accept. If he accepts reason alone as the basis of his knowledge, that is rationalism, this is where Bonson shone so greatly when he talked about this, he still has no guarantee that his thoughts actually correspond to anything outside of it. And that causes problems. It denies the autonomous thinker any assurance that his thoughts and reasons, however exact they may be, within his own little mental world of his mind, actually provide knowledge of the real world of tangible objects. If only abstract truths of reason provide certainty, then how can we trust anything outside of that? As Dr. Frame put it, rationalism seeks the most abstract knowledge possible, but in doing that, it finds it can make no specific claims about the world. Honestly, therefore, the rationalist cannot assure himself that anything but his immaterial thoughts actually provide knowledge. And so while the theory of rationalism sounds very strong and bold, in practice, it actually traps you in irrationalism, because you cannot truly know anything besides that small fraction of thoughts that are in your head. And if he can't assure himself, then he certainly can't assure anyone else. And therefore, the autonomous thinker can't communicate truth, even if he had it. Anything he says can arrive to another person only as sense perceptions. Audible voices, observed texts, not on the head, not deductive reasons. The listener may construct his own deductive reasons as he receives those perceptions, but those reasons will not be foundational for that person. These constructed reasons will themselves be derived from something other than pure reason. So each individual can at best manufacture their own pure reasons, independent of other people and external stimulations. No one can definitively prove their reasons to another because communication requires elements of knowledge beyond pure reasoning to do so. It results from this, however, that we can never have a guarantee that the thoughts of any two people actually correspond at any two points. In short, rationalism destroys communication. So in the attempt to guarantee knowledge, reason alone fails to assure the thinker of the simplest facts in the universe, and it logically traps the reasoner within the solitary confinement of his own brain. He can't claim to know anything beyond his logical, mathematical thoughts. He can't know any single fact about the world around him or another person, and he can't communicate what he does know. Yet the classical alternative to reason alone knowledge fails just as badly. The standard of evidence, as we talked about earlier, seeing, falls under what philosophers have classically called empiricism, knowledge gained through sense perceptions. This is the seeing is believing school. And such a standard gains wide acceptance today because it's widely popularized by people who talk about science. We must have observation and measurable experiment. Only that which humans can detect, can observe, can measure, can manipulate, do empiricists consider knowledge. But this standard encounters its own problems. Most importantly, philosophers have long since exposed the fact, and why modern atheists who refer to this don't remember this after 400 years, I don't know, long exposed the inconsistency of empiricism because it fails its own test. The claim that only that which is true, which can be verified empirically, cannot itself be verified empirically. We've got no evidence that proves that only evidence provides truth, or even that it provides any truth. So to maintain the basic commitment of empiricism requires the autonomous thinker to make totally unsupported and unsupportable assumptions. And so the adoption of this standard requires, again, a subjective choice on the part of the thinker, and the ultimate authority to make it is the individual himself. Again, this is nothing but human autonomy unleashed. Again, it goes to the same problems of relativism, it goes to the same problems of communication as rationalism did. And so, in the history of philosophical thought, of which I am learned, but not an expert, I admit, you have had people who have tried to reconcile the two. The most famous in our age is Kant. Kant gets all the credit for trying to bring rationalism and empiricism together in one seamless doctrine of knowledge. The guy who doesn't get as much credit, who did it before him and did it much better, was Francis Bacon. The guy who invented the scientific method said, we've got to make human observations, measurable experiments, and then theorize from those in the rational in order to learn from them. He actually did something productive in his life with that. Kant was just a very sophisticated smarty pants. And Kant wrote large books that were poorly written in German and even more poorly translated into English, very difficult to read, trying to reconcile these two streams of thought. And as the philosophers have put it, and I'm just repeating the things I've heard and read down through the ages, what good does it do to take one leaky bucket and put it in another leaky bucket? It's still not going to hold water. Which, by the way, recalls Jeremiah, God condemning the Israelite people for the rebellion from his pure word and saying that you have hewed yourselves cisterns, but they won't hold water. They're leaky buckets, they're broken cisterns, and they won't hold water. And this is exactly the image that, thankfully, some philosophers have given us for this. The atheist philosopher hurled this at Christians who were evidentialists, who gave him an argument that didn't quite measure up to prove God. And so they gave him another evidential argument that didn't quite prove, but they kept giving him more and more and more and more, and thinking, well, if we give him enough, this cumulative case will convince him. And he finally said, if one leaky bucket won't hold water, what's the reason to think that 10 can? What he unwittingly illustrated, however, was not only the failure of evidence-only thinking, but the failure of any human-centered theory of knowledge to prove anything. Without the existence of a creator of an objective world, self-authenticating, revealing God, and an ultimate judge of truth and falsity, we've got no guarantee that human reason and experience actually correspond to reality, or that the experiences of individual human beings actually occur within an intelligible and social and mutually accountable environment. And that is the soundbite for the ages. Without those things, without that God and that revelation from Him, the human mind can only arbitrarily assume that objectivity and knowledge exist, can only arbitrarily assume that they are authoritative for all people, and by that, contradicting the very ideas of objectivity and knowledge, because he's stating it on his own authority. That's what happens to knowledge when you go down this path. What happens to law and morality, which is the next step? Well, if you have relativism in knowledge, what do you think that flows into? You see it all around you. Relativism in morals. Relativism in law. In all forms of law. And the courts are showing that when it comes to things like marriage. And have long since shown when it comes to life. Things are relative. And if you follow it out to its logical conclusions, you get the belief that just as every man is an island when it comes to the authority of his own knowledge, every man is an island when it comes to the authority of his values. And that's not just my deduction, folks. The atheists today, the new atheists, who want to put on this facade of abandoning God from the universe and yet upholding this great moral universe, are painfully aware of this problem. They do not want you to bring up the names Friedrich Nietzsche. They do not want you to bring up the names Marquis de Sade, which most of them don't even know about. Maybe the liberals at NPR know about him, but they don't want to talk about this. And yet, it doesn't just begin to bring relativism into morals, it absolutely destroys anything that could be called morality. It drives to what Friedrich Nietzsche called the absolution, absolution, as in absolving, dissolving, dissolution, we shall say, of all values. Because the one value that transcends them all is man. Individual man. Let me read you a couple quotations as I draw a little nearer to closing. This is from Mr. Sod, the Marquis, who was so radical that even the French Revolution didn't want him. And he said, very observant, very astute, this is key. This is the stuff you want to write down. You can get copies of it, I've got it written online. This is the stuff you want to write down and show to atheists at a later date. For what should we, who have no religion, do with law? Nature equally dictating virtues and vices in us, in reason of the need nature has of the one and the other, what she inspires in us becomes a very reliable gauge by which to adjust exactly what is good and bad. No religion, no law, just the impulses of nature. And from that, the Marquis de Sade began to come up with a system of morals. He wanted to abolish capital punishment. Well, that's not so radical, right? He wanted to abolish all laws against murder. Murder's natural. It just happens sometimes. He wanted to abolish all laws against incest. He wanted to promote the social acceptance of sodomy and pederasty, infanticide, and the unbridled embrace of all sexual impulse of any nature, even the most vulgar, as he put it in one of his plays, even of eating feces. And he advocated strongly for the forced submission of women to men unconditionally. It's natural. Don't shrink back in fear at this, folks. This is natural, what we're talking about here. He says, "What right do you have to assert that women ought to be exempted from the blind submission of men's caprices? Nature dictates. We have received from nature the right indiscriminately to express our wishes to all women. We have the right to compel their submission. Indeed, has nature not proven that we have that right by bestowing upon us the strength needed to bend women to our will? I have incontestable rights of the enjoyment of her. I have the right to force from her this enjoyment if she refuses me it for whatever cause may be. And once you've conceded me the proprietary right of enjoyment, that right is independent of all effects it produces. The issue of her well-being is irrelevant. As soon as concern for this consideration threatens to detract from or enfeeble the enjoyment of him who desires her, the consideration of age ceases to exist." So you understand what happens when someone takes the theory of nature, applies it to morals, and drives it to its logical conclusion. And thankfully, I don't have to do that. I've got an atheist who did it for me. The best antidote against an atheist sometimes is another atheist, a more consistent atheist. And these guys are the gold standard of atheists. Marquis de Sade, from the work entitled Philosophy in the Bedroom. By the way, I don't advocate reading this unless you are very prayed up, as my Pentecostal friends would put it. Nietzsche. Nietzsche was another one of these consistent atheists, and he looked across the English Channel and he saw some other atheists riding over there in the literary world of Victorians, and he singled one young lady out, the author of a book about Silas Marner, named George Eliot. She was an atheist, but she was a fierce champion of morality. An atheist lowered his scope upon this and wrote, "They are rid of the Christian God and now believe all the more firmly that they must cling to Christian morality. This is an English inconsistency. We do not wish to hold it against little moralistic females, a la Eliot. In England, one must rehabilitate oneself after every little emancipation from theology by showing in a veritably awe-inspiring manner what a moral fanatic one is. That's the penance they pay there. We others hold otherwise. Listen to this. When one gives up the Christian faith, one pulls the right to Christian morality out from under one's feet. This morality is by no means self-evident. This point has to be exhibited again and again, despite the English flatheads. Christianity is a system, a whole view of things thought out together. By breaking one main concept out of it, the faith in God, one breaks the whole. Nothing necessary remains in one's hand. Christianity presupposes that man does not know, cannot know what is good for him, what evil. He believes in God who alone knows it. Christian morality is a command. Its origin is transcendent. It is beyond all criticism, all right to criticism. It has truth only if God has truth. It stands or falls with faith in God." Preach it, brother. I got lost in this reading and I thought I was in Van Til for a moment and it was Nietzsche. When the English actually believe that they know intuitively what is good and evil, when they therefore suppose that they no longer require Christianity as the guarantee of morality, we merely witness the effects of the dominion of the Christian value judgment and an expression of the strength and depth of this dominion. such that the origin of English morality has been forgotten, such that the very conditional character of its right to existence is no longer felt, where the English morality is not yet a problem. What's Mr. Nietzsche saying? You atheists aren't being consistent enough. You've still got this crazy thing called morality, and that ain't atheist, that's Christian. One more, and I'll try to wrap this up. From Nietzsche's book, The Twilight of the Idols, how far we too are still pious. In science, convictions, he means dogmas, have no right of citizenship. Only when they decide to condescend to the modesty of a hypothesis, of a provisional experimental point of view, of a regulative fiction, may they be granted admission under the police of mistrust. But one must still ask whether it is not the case that, in order that this discipline could begin, a conviction must have been there already. And even such a commanding and unconditional one that it sacrificed all other convictions for its own sake. It is clear that science, too, rests on faith. There is no science without presuppositions. The conviction is expressed. Nothing is needed more than truth. This unconditional will to truth, what is it? What do you know in advance of the character of existence to be able to decide whether the greater advantage is on the side of the unconditionally mistrustful, the skeptic, or of the unconditionally trusting, the faithful? Thus the question, why science, leads back to the moral problem. For what end any morality at all, if life, nature, and history are not moral? One will have gathered what I'm driving at, namely, it will always remains a metaphysical faith upon which our faith in science rests. Even we devotees of knowledge today, we godless ones, we anti-metaphysicians, still take our fire, too, from the flame which a faith thousands of years old has kindled, that Christian faith, which was also Plato's faith. He's wrong about that, but we can forgive him. That God is truth, and that truth is divine. Now, Nietzsche was not trying to be a Christian apologist by any means. He was trying to show his atheist followers that they hadn't gone far enough. They needed to blow up the dikes completely. Destroy everything, level it to the foundations, and get down to the dirty work of being supermen ourselves, doing everything for ourselves, rid ourselves from all of that baggage. I mean all of it. But the more he tried, the more he had to confront his fellow atheists and say, you know what? Your morality is actually Christian morality. You know what? Your science is actually Christian science. And the more he dealt with this, the more he revealed that if you want intellectual thought, if you want morality, you have to presuppose the Christian worldview. And we should attack today, if we're going to be faithful to Scripture in apologetics, understanding that that person knows God. They know morality. They know the foundations of science. They know the God of all of it, and they know Him clearly. Your job is to not try to jump into His scientific worldview that's built on His fallen presupposition, that's built on His rebellion, and try to join Him in rebellion in order to produce evidence for God. Your job is to attack the foundations of what he believes and show him where it leads. And the intellectual challenge of the gospel is this challenge. You have a choice between Christian faith or utter irrationality, chaos, murder, warfare. That is the choice before you. And that you have to leave with him and the Holy Spirit. Because you will never argue anyone into heaven. But you can present the truth to them. And if they are elect, God will take them home. God will bring them in. And if they're not, they will be forced to live out the rest of the years embracing irrationality and fighting against that. And holding down and suppressing that truth and unrighteousness becomes harder than it ever would before. And it drives them crazy. I don't have time this evening to go into some of the criticisms that have come from other apologists. Perhaps that's for the better. One of the things I understand Bonson did more as he got older was actually engage in use of the method rather than the argumentation of the method with other Christians. Not that he ever abandoned that. And perhaps that should be the way we go more often. Nevertheless, there are some outstanding criticisms. I wish I could have gotten to them this evening. However, what's before us is Scripture, and that is the most important thing, that we don't hold the truth in unrighteousness. We don't exchange the image of God that is in us for an image that looks like corruptible men and beasts and snakes. We don't want the methodology of the serpent. We want the methodology of our Creator that He's revealed to us, given to us. Amen. Amen. Amen.